Jess, again, Chris, welcome to the fun. Thank you so much for taking some time out of your day to share how you all are doing, how you all are doing, and how you all are managing your telemedicine adventures with your patients. I'm going to hand it off to you, and we're going to have ourselves a go. Thanks again.
Awesome.
Yeah, we appreciate you guys inviting us into the fold here. One of our goals for telemedicine was, I guess our main goal was, how do we do telemedicine full time and not compromise all of the systems we had in place already? You know, the way we like to engage patients, whether it's individual or in a group class, or the fun little things we do to try to, you know, diffuse frustrations, you know, as patients walk in. How do we maintain the integrity of what we work so hard for here on a computer screen? And so a lot of the stuff that that we're going to show you is helping us do just that. One of the first things that that we struggled with and that we had to refine was, where do patients go to get the right link for the visit? You know, we each have our own Zoom rooms. We do not have a Zoom business account. On some level, just for the way we're set up, it doesn't make sense for us to do that. We tried a couple of other methods for telehealth software, and just landed with Zoom right now. We've made sure that we have turned on all the HIPAA compliance portions of that, and are just kind of abiding by the rules there. But I want to show you. Let me share my screen with you. I want to show you what we did with our website to make it easy for patients to log onto our rooms. Okay. So our patients, can everybody, can we see that?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're good.
All right. So our patients go to our website, and we try not to make them go to too many places to get information. We try to direct them back to our website. And so if your facility is struggling with getting the right link out to patients or whatever, this may be a good idea. We created a telehealth page. And so when they go to our telehealth page, we literally have just telehealth instructions, and this has been tweaked, I will tell you. It did not start out like this because patients kept saying, oh, well, that part was confusing or this part was confusing. So all the red and the bold and the stop sign, that was not there on day one. But they come here, and when they hover, they get, you know, step number one, instructions on how to upload your data. And step number two, they use our patient portal app to check in online. Before I will see them, they have to do these two things right here. If for some reason it's like, you know, 5 after, 10 minutes after their visit is supposed to start, because my visits tend to be a little bit longer, got a little bit more time to plug in, I will start the televisit, and I'll tell them, hey, I wanted to go ahead and start, but I noticed that you haven't checked in and you haven't uploaded your data yet. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put you in the Zoom waiting room, and I want you to go to our website, and I'll chat them the link right here. I literally just copy the link, put it on the chat, and I say, I want you to go here and follow the instructions. And that's all I tell them. And then I say, all right, see you guys in a little bit. I'm going to put you back in the waiting room. And that's what I do. It's training them to kind of do things the right way. It's a bit of an investment for the next visit so that it goes smoother. We have the big stop sign right here that says, have you followed steps 1 and 2 above? And then it's a reminder about how our visits are set up. We have shared visits, and then we have individual visits. So there's different instructions for each one. But this is me. This is our dietitian. And then this is Jessica. And so if they want my room, they literally just click right here, and it takes them directly to my Zoom room. They don't have to know a link or remember a link or search for an email. They just know that they can go to this site, and it's the same room every time I see on Zoom, when and a lot of the other softwares too that have waiting rooms. I see that, you know, a patient has been put in your waiting room, and then I choose when to admit them into the actual visit. So that was step number one for us, but it was updating our website to reflect the process that we wanted patients to work through to get onto the actual visit. So let me get off of that. All right, I figured what would be most beneficial is if I just kind of started from the beginning of the visit, but I wanted to share a picture of our setup, because that's what a lot of you guys are probably interested in. So here's an image of, this is literally my desk. Don't be too impressed, because we didn't spend a lot of money on any one thing. We certainly, you know, our laptops are our laptops. We choose to go Mac here in our practice. Jessica and I personally have used Macs just in our own houses for years and years, and so it made sense to do what we know. But you don't have to use Mac computers. But I have a monitor on my left. I have a monitor on my right, and I have a hub mounted, just Velcro to the back of my desk, where all of this stuff is connected. But this allows us to kind of go to keep one thing on this screen. So my EMR is always on the left screen. Always, always, always. I never share the EMR with patients. So I know I just get in the habit of never sharing my left screen. My middle screen is actually, that's the one that I use to put the actual Zoom room on. So I can see the patient, and I choose the view that's just the patient, because I do not like looking at myself while I'm talking. And I make them as big as I can make them, so they're right in the middle, because my camera is in the middle. So I put the patient right underneath the camera so that they feel like I'm actually looking at them. And then everything on the right side of the screen is what I share with the patient. So whether I'm sharing their Tidepool account with them, whether I'm sharing our website, because sometimes patient will ask, hey, you know, there's a class I was going to sign up for. How do I do that? And I literally just share the screen with them and say, hey, you go here to classes, and I'll walk them down so that they know how to do it. But nothing on the left screen gets shared with the patient ever, because, you know, there's sensitive information that you can accidentally share. It's a good habit just to go ahead and lock yourself into a setup to make sure that you don't have an accident down the road, because there's certain things on a patient's chart that I don't think it's appropriate for them to see. You can kind of see on the left here, I didn't hire a very good photographer here, evidently, but I have a light right here. It's just a little desktop light. You can see the tripod stand underneath, but these lights are extremely bright. And if I had them just in front of me, I would probably have to, you know, visit an optometrist within the next, you know, couple of hours, because they're so bright. But what I did was that I just kind of tucked them behind my monitor. So literally what you see right here, that's the only portion of the light that is sticking out of my monitor. And I have one on the right side as well. And that's what you see right here. So exactly what I look like on screen right now is what the patient sees. I'm not using any sort of different setup. And then I have the they call them like selfie lights. You can put them on your cell phones or your iPads. A lot of vloggers use them. It adds just enough light to where there's no shadow. There's no dark spot right in the middle. So I have light from this side, I have light from this side, and I have light coming right in the middle. None of these lights were expensive, but they do a really good job. Jessica has a little different setup because her office is much, much brighter than mine. My office is at kind of the corner of the building, and it's just dark. It just stays dark all the time. So I approach it a little bit differently than she would.
Chris, we got a quick question about sure. this setup. It seems very intentional in how, how you arrange things for you, but also how you are presented to your patients. Did you receive a lot of feedback on this? Like, I guess my question is more of what was the sort of iteration process to get to your current setup right now? Was that based off of your own experience, your own preference, or was it patient feedback? How did you sort of evolve from where you started to where you are today?
It's not patient feedback. I think, you know, I do tend to be a little bit more tech minded. I've always been into audio visual type stuff just on the side. I, you know, try to exercise that creative part of my brain. I don't know. I've always been kind of a borderline tech nerd. I don't get too deep into it, but I really enjoy it. And so some of it was just trial and error. Before telehealth, before we actually had to use a camera, I only use, let me share the screen one more time so I can point to things. Okay, we should be back on there in that same image again.
Yeah.
So we didn't always have the laptops in the middle. We started out just running dual monitors for our offices because even though we see patients all day, we're also the business owners and we have lots of just business stuff that we're working on and multitasking. And so I'll often have, you know, patient data here, you know, Tide Pool, EMR, and then I have some business stuff on the other side. Sometimes I'm, you know, working on business documents and copy and pasting back and forth. And so it started out with just two monitors, but instead of purchasing a webcam to attach to one of these monitors, it just made sense for us to open our laptops and use the camera that's actually on top of the opened screen. So that was really more of a money saver at that point, because we already had the laptops with you know, nice webcams built in. And so if you notice there's overlap right here. I try to keep these monitors as close as possible because I don't really need this entire screen. I just need to see the patient right in the middle. So I often have them even a little bit closer than what they are right now. But yeah, it did evolve just a little bit, but wireless mouse, wireless keyboard, and it's actually solar powered, so I never have to charge it. There's no cable. I don't have to worry about that. So I can easily get these things out of the way, move cables around, cords around, because it does get kind of complicated, a little bit messy when you have so many cables on the desk. One thing I didn't mention is that I also have an iPad here. I love to draw pictures for patients. That's honestly, that's one of the things that I was most worried about, not being able to sit in front of a patient and actually draw diabetes for them. I'm a very visual learner. And so to just sit there and explain things to me all day long, it doesn't necessarily work. I'll show you, let me share the iPad screen and I'll show you kind of how it works. Okay, so there's my iPad screen, and I we do subscribe to the Adobe suite, and so we have all of the Adobe services. So this is just Adobe Draw, actually this is Adobe Sketch, and so if I want to, you know, explain something to someone, I'm going to draw a picture and be like, okay, this is you, right? You don't get hands today. I actually try to make it look just like them, even though I'm a horrible artist. So if I have a kid that's got spiky hair, you're going to get spiky hair on here. And I'm going to draw a blood vessel and I'm going to say, all right, this is all the glucose in here. And I have my Apple Pencil set up on a double tap. So when I double tap the pencil, it pulls up a different color and I can go, all right, so this is a cell. And how does the glucose get into the cell? Let's talk about that. And I draw these elaborate pictures. I'll pull one up for you. So it ends up looking like that in the end. It's a little bit messy when you and overwhelming when you just look at it. But this was actually for a nursing student that was in our clinic, and I had a patient that was an older patient that was really intrigued by, you know, the intricacies of how things worked. And so we try to get creative with patients and keep them engaged in several different ways. We know that everybody is not an auditory learner exclusively. A lot of people genuinely want to see it. They want to put their hands on it. They want to manipulate it, draw it, just see it in a different format. So that's the iPad. One of my favorites. It's just one of my favorite things that we do is drawing diabetes. I won't get too deep into the EMR. Everybody uses a different EMR, and so it allows us to do different things. But this, what I'm sharing now is my left screen. This is just a test patient. You can see it's obviously me. During the visit, I'm engaged with them. I'm looking straight at them in the camera, but the entire time I'm just sitting here charting and I'm clicking buttons. And I'm going down the patient visit just to make sure that I've got all the information. We also use our iPad to get graphics into our EMR. We can't, so I'll take a screenshot of something from Tidepool and I airdrop it. If you're familiar with Macs, you can airdrop things. It's just kind of a way for Macs to communicate with other Mac products or Apple products. But I airdrop the screenshot of our Tidepool like trend graph. I drop it to my iPad and I use the EMR app on my iPad to put the graphic in. Now it's a little bit cumbersome, but this is how our EMR company requests that it be done. It's got to be done through the iPad. So another use for the iPad during the visit. But eventually we get everything done in our visit. The first thing I do with patients is, you know, I'm sitting here talking to them face-to-face. We're talking about real-life diabetes, but I always ask them, and you may have noticed this on my note that I just showed you, I ask them very first, how frustrated are you with diabetes? Okay, that's the very first question I ask in every single visit. 0 to 10, how frustrated are you with diabetes? And saw a new patient right before this call today. They said, the dad was like, I'm an 8. And the mom said, I'm a 4. I said, okay, well, let's average them together. You tell me why you're an 8. You tell me why you're a 4. Tell me why it's not a 0. And they list out all of their frustrations. So immediately after that, I share, this is the reason I'm telling you, immediately after that, I go to the share screen function. And I say, all right, well, let's take a look at you on paper. And they'll go, what do you mean, you on paper? And what I mean is, my screen's got messed up here. Okay. So I'll pull up like the trend graph, and we just have a test patient pulled up here. We try to take their frustrations and let them look at themselves on paper and see if their frustrations actually match the data. Because we know real life diabetes, there's two very, very, not opposing or competing perspectives, but sometimes they can oppose each other. The way you feel is not always the way you look on paper, and the way you look on paper is not always how you feel. So I let them look at the trend graph. I'll take them through each of the daily views, you know, as we're looking at this particular patient is on the Control IQ. And so we talk about the different aspects of their day. But one of the things I wanted to point out, this is a total pun here. We have a cursor, we have a cursor app installed on our browser. And so if I've got, you know, a lot of our patients are pediatric patients. So I'll go, all right, little Susie, pick Marvel or Disney, which one? And they'll go, Disney. So I'll go, all right, let's go down to Disney. And so I'll let them look at it. I've already shared my screen with them. So they're looking at my cursor. They'll go, oh, we want Mickey Mouse. So I'll choose Mickey Mouse. So now I have a Mickey Mouse cursor. And I can point to different things on the screen with a Mickey Mouse cursor, and the Mickey Mouse, you know, changes. I may have a kid who is totally into Marvel comics. And so I'll go to the Marvel one and they go, oh man, I really want Deadpool. So, all right, well, let's choose Deadpool. I can make it bigger. Again, this is part of just kind of trying to do my normal task of diffusing a patient's frustrations before we actually get too deep into the visit. So I have looked at them face to face with my center screen here. We've talked about all their frustrations. We then go over to the trend graph where they may or may not be happy about what they see. We're playing around with cursors, we're having fun, and we're pointing things out. So now they're actually ready to do the visit after all of that. So there's several very intentional steps in the order of which we do things, but hopefully that gives you a little bit of idea of how it's all set up. I will, unless there's a specific question, I guess I'll turn it over to Jessica, because when I finish my visits, what I do, and I would say, please pay attention to this wording, because this is something that we had a staff meeting, an all staff meeting yesterday, and I had to emphasize to everyone else in the meeting, the way that you word things is very, very important, because patients are either going to listen to you exactly, or they're going to do their version of what they thought you just said. So I say, all right, I need for you to log off of my Zoom room. Now, I've already told them where the website is and where the link is on the website. So I say, go to the website, log off of my Zoom room, log onto Jessica's Zoom room. And when she's finished with her current patient, she will take you out of her waiting room and she'll put you into the actual visit. Everything good? Patients say, okay, yeah, I'm good. I know how to do it. And that works really, really well. If you don't word things carefully, there's a chance that patients will just log off and then they're done. You don't know where they went. And it's like, oh, well, they were supposed to see the dietitian, or they were supposed to see Jessica, or we had to talk about something else, or maybe we didn't schedule a follow-up. Or so then you've lost them. Now you got to call them, got to get them on the phone. Hey, I'm not sure what happened. I'm not sure if I was what I said was confusing to you, but you need to log on to Jessica's room and we need to do a follow-up visit. So you have to be really careful when you're transitioning them from one link to the next, because you could potentially lose the patient for the visit. And that has certainly happened. So a little bit of growing pains there. But I will stop sharing my screen here. And Jessica, I will let you have it.
So thank you, Chris. So I guess, Jessica, in part of, as you are preparing to talk about your process, I guess, is the order of operations always Chris and then you, or Chris and somebody else? Like, are you always seeing patients last? I guess either way, like, how do you sort of frame the context for what you can assume patients have already done beyond potentially just uploading their data, as it relates to how you prepare for your appointments with your patients as they're coming in to see you?
So the majority of our patients are shared Chris and then me, if it's a diabetes education appointment, intentionally, because he basically can set the stage for what I'm about to explain. So Chris and I have worked together long enough that we kind of mirror each other in all things, not just in education, but even in, like he said, we're both business owners. Like, he does one set, I do the other, and we kind of work together that way. So he knows where I'm going and I know what he's accomplished. Our notes are very intentionally set up. And so as long as we're having a good day and not an absolutely chaotic day, the day will flow out, whether it be telehealth or in person. I can read his note as he is going through it, and I know what is going on. I know where the patient is. I know where their frustrations are. I can read the frustrations, and sometimes I need to read nothing else because I know where Chris is taking that. So I think that's the important part of that, is knowing your educator and having a good reporting system and having things in place. Because if an educator is seeing a patient and then the provider has no information, then you repeat things and patients get frustrated and they're like, well, I just said that. But with our dietitian appointments, it depends on what's going on. It depends on the type of patient. The only time that I see a patient before Chris or our dietitian Maddie is simply if I need to make a change in what the patient is doing. So if I'm about to change medications, or I'm about to change, we have some adults coming into our practice who are on fixed dosing, and I want to say, okay, today I know you're ready for carb counting, finally. Thank you. Wow, it's been a long time, but we're ready now. So here's what I'm gonna do. And then I write the orders, I tell them, and I explain that you're about to now go into an appointment with Chris, and he is going to really explain that in more detail. They've already, by that point, worked with the dietitian, understood carb counting, shown me by documentation of Tidepool that they can keep track of their carbs. Now I know they're ready. So if I think they're getting ready to be ready, I will tell our office manager, I want what we call a reverse shared. It throws the whole schedule, looks really funny, and our office staff have just kind of learned to live with it. But Chris knows what reverse shared means. Maddie, our dietitian, knows what reverse shared means. So the way we schedule our patients is also a way that we communicate with one another.
Okay. Question from me. Actually, I'm mostly curious because I'm part of the support system on Tidepool. And I know that we get this question a lot from clinicians whenever they're considering using Tidepool as their primary data platform. How much time do you spend troubleshooting upload issues? Like, I would prefer personally that you send everybody to support at Tidepool.org, but that's not always going to be the case. But in terms of Tidepool troubleshooting, how much time do you feel like you're spending helping patients navigate that stuff before you can actually get to the meat of any appointment that you have upcoming with them?
That's all. So
I used the word investment earlier. Mm-hmm. I've learned Tidepool pretty well. I'll send you guys a bill at the end of the year.
I'll send you a t-shirt.
Okay. That's a good trade. So I do spend, it's not necessarily time troubleshooting the software. It's troubleshooting the patient's ability to use any software.
Okay.
Some patients are naturally just inclined to technology. They'll go to the Tidepool website and they'll pull up, the help portion, or they'll search for whatever they search for and they'll figure it out on their own. But most patients are going to go, hey, we tried to do this and we couldn't do it. Okay, well, let's work on that real quick. So that to me is a part of diabetes education in the flavor and the style that we present diabetes education. Technology used to be somewhat peripheral to diabetes management. It is no longer peripheral. It is absolutely central. So I feel like if we're doing our job right, we're teaching them how to use the technology. So in terms of how the visit flows, me teaching them how to use their, or me teaching them how to pair their Dexcom G6 with Apple Health with Tidepool is just as important as me saying, hey, I want you to make sure you really accurately count those carbs. It's a part of it. If they can't troubleshoot from home, if I'm not teaching them how to do that, then they're going to find themselves eventually in a situation where they can't get past the hurdle. And the way that we run our practice is that we have a 24/7 on-call system. They can reach us. So what that does, if it's 2 a.m. and you have a 5-year-old that's vomiting because she has a stomach bug and she's on the verge of DKA with moderate ketones, I'm going to hear their story at 2 a.m. I'm going to let them tell me what just happened. My next question is going to be, have you uploaded to Tidepool? So that's a big thing. At 2 a.m, and listen, we have patients now. We have trained them. They know when to call us. They'll go, hey, so he's been vomiting for the last 2 hours. We just uploaded to Tidepool. Can you please look at it and help us? Okay. My opinion, I think we would all land maybe in a little different spot with it, but my opinion is that helping them troubleshoot technology is a part of the visit most days. There are a couple of patients, some of them you're probably aware of in our practice, that just have these weird tech issues that, I mean, I have no clue how to fix it. And I will say, hey, you need to email Tidepool because I'm done. Like, I have no clue what to do next. So I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, it does. Actually, I have another question in from one of the attendees who used that Q&A button at the bottom. Thank you. This is from Jonathan. How do you navigate? So Tidepool is great. I'm a little bit biased, but for patients that are using an insulin pump, how do you navigate patients that are not yet on an insulin pump with or without Tidepool?
So we have a couple of alternatives for transmitting data. There are several apps out there. You've got, your One Touch Reveal, you've got OneDrop, the list goes on, your AccuCheck app. We will allow patients to use those apps to track data, to track insulin doses. NPIN is a big thing now too. And so we've spent a lot of time also encouraging our patients, and this is where sometimes we have a split in the road when it comes to all 20-something of us agreeing. But we are Apple heavy here because when it comes to integrating technology, your applications and Tidepool or whatever other software you may be using, Apple tends to be a little bit friendlier to these devices and to these methods than the Android platforms. I really don't have anything against Android. We've just found we've been able to lower people's frustrations by them switching to an iPhone. So now they can seamlessly integrate all of their products. So we do spend time up front encouraging them to get an iPhone if they're thinking about that. The reason I say that is because it matters how we connect them on the back end. It just makes it a lot easier. Right. But we've used the OneDrop app quite a bit. If patients want us to do certain things, we'll say, hey, I don't expect for you to log everything all the time, but for the next 4 days, can you put all of your doses in there? Can you put your carbs in there, track all the data, and then send us a message through our patient message portal, and just tell us, hey, check Tidepool. That's what we tell people. Just send us a message and go check Tidepool. We know what it means. We know that you want us to look at your data and make a suggestion. So if they're not on an insulin pump, they're either on an InPen or they're tracking data manually. So that's kind of what it gets boiled down to. And I'd be happy to go into specifics about that with anybody. I don't want to get too caught in the weeds right now. But yeah, we do have systems in place for that.
And basically, when he says manually, we don't accept paper logs. If you're doing a handwritten log, history has proven itself that patients don't like to do handwritten logs, teenagers, adults, or parents. Your handwritten log for us is OneDrop. So OneDrop can do tons of things, and it's our handwritten log. Essentially, it's what they manually do. All patients, if you can't upload anything, we haven't had a patient yet who doesn't have some sort of technology that can upload at least a OneDrop app. But the other part of this is that all the other technology systems, it puts us at risk for making errors on the backside. So we use Tidepool with OneDrop, and sometimes a couple of the other meters that are on an Android phone that can't be gotten into Tidepool, because if we're looking at data over and over again and patients send us in data, we get about, like right now on my screen, on my patient screen, I have 20 patient messages. Probably 75% of those are, can you check my Tidepool or can you check my data? And if we're looking and making glucose adjustments throughout in between patient visits, we want to make sure that what we're doing is doing it safely. And so having that continuity of a visual field, and we're looking and we say, okay, we know what these screens look like, and I'm going to review that in a second, but we know what it means. It's easy to read, and it's not going to put us at much risk for either error or increased time that we just can't get back. We can't get reimbursed for, and it takes a lot of time if you don't have it seamless like this.
Yeah.
Chris, there was a time when this is before we decided to go to one system. Okay. Patients, just however you could upload, this was years and years ago. I counted 20 something. I think it was like 22 different methods of patients submitting data. And I went into Jessica's office one day and I said, what's going to happen one day? We're going to make a medical error. Because we're used, maybe the glucose level's on the X axis on this one. Maybe it's on the Y axis on this other software. Maybe it's just a completely different layout altogether, and it just takes more time. But the chances of us misreading something and making a medical error are much higher if we don't consistently use the same system. So we told all patients, your go-to is going to be Tidepool and OneDrop. There are plenty of other softwares out there that work really well. That's just where we landed. I don't think everybody has to land where we land, but it's worked great for us, and the patients have really taken well to it. I'd probably say less than 5% of our patients are ever using some sort of other method of communicating their data.
Yeah.
All right. So Jessica, we've gotten a good look at Chris's setup and how he navigates patients. Are you as artistically minded as he is when it comes to how you go through and how you're, navigating patient data and in those patient visits with you?
Yeah, so I am not artistic at all. I don't think visually at all. I just so happen to have Chris as my business partner.
Okay.
But I will say that what I do in my visits completely mirrors what I would do in office. And so Chris mentioned that we're all Apple. And part of that is I can take my laptop, I pick it up, and I take it into a room. And we have an Apple TV in all of our rooms and a computer screen. And so what that gives us the ability to do is pull up and have a discussion. So when I go into my patient visit, I'm going to share my screen and I'm going to show you. They don't see this part of it, but they will see, they will have me going through it. So I immediately, this is my, like Chris says, we do it on the left and the right. It just visually, it's easier, and we just know. So my setup looks like his in regards to computer. It's just my lighting is different because you can see it's just a lot brighter back here. And I have no lights but two lamps, and it doesn't look much different on the face. But I go directly to this section right here. So when Chris mentioned that they need to go to upload their data and they need to do on patient, it's because I need this information. This information that you're seeing on the screen right here, which is not filled out, but we can fill it out real quick and just run with it. But like all this on the screen is what your medical assistant would be getting for you, or you would have in like Tidepool. If it's a pump, you would have it. But if it's specifically, if it's a an MDI regimen, you're not going to have that information. So we get this. If we don't have it, I have to stop and ask for it. So then that's going to take time. And if you're trying to mimic a regular office setting and you don't have a medical assistant who is working up your patient before you go in, you have to have this. So that's where we start. And I just verify the information is there. So I'm like, okay, so you're on Traceba, 15 units, 1 per 6. And sometimes they're like, oh no, that's not what I'm doing. And I'm like, oh, so mom filled it out, but the child's doing something different. So I always verify it. And then we kind of go through that process. I ask, clarification, make sure it's all good. But then I shift directly into the Tidepool look. And that's where I spend the most time for my visit, because it's time now. Chris has kind of laid the groundwork. He has went through all of the emotional aspects. He has left notes, so I know where certain things are going. I know why patients are doing what they're doing a lot. So he kind of helps me be able to move through my visit a little bit more quickly. But we land directly on this. See, I have a rose because I love Disney and Belle and all things. So I don't always give them a choice. It really makes the boys laugh if I'm like on a rose and they're like, seriously, Miss Jessica? But they've all known me and they just know that this is just who I am.
There was a comment from the attendees about your mouse choice. So thank you for specifying that.
Yes, the mouse thing is, when Chris finally put this on here, this was probably like a couple of weeks into us doing telehealth. It truly changed everything. It was super fun and the kids were more entertained because, you know, when you're talking to patients, sometimes they're distracted. Sometimes they could care less. You throw Belle up on the screen for a little girl and she's just like, oh my gracious. So now you have like a 7 or 8 year old who could care less about her visit because her mom's carrying on a conversation. And now, well, we have Belle on the screen. So we just got their attention. So the first thing I do, and this, now this can be done in any platform that you're looking at. If you're pulling up your report, there's always some sort of basic screen. Then there's always a way to see the daily and the trends. But the patient and I go through this, this screen to start making decisions. And it's also to kind of see where they are. This BG readings is not super accurate. I didn't realize it until afterwards that what we did is, this is a test patient and it's a control IQ tandem pump. So unfortunately you don't see any of this except right here. And this is right before he started. It's a newer pump. So I think that was what was going on, or either his Dexcom was off. So you normally see this. And if it, say this was a MDI patient who was on an NPIN, I could see how many times they used their glucoses to calculate their data. And then your boluses, which this looks extreme, but remember, probably could have thought better about it and we did a control IQ. So this looks very different than it would for an MDI. But if we have a patient on MDI and NPIN, this screen looks the same as on a pump. This is why we use Tidepool. It makes it easier. So I can talk to them about the time that he's in range. And this is taking his Dexcom data. And I know that because it's right here. So we talk about this. This is something I do spend a lot of time on right here, this low portion, because sometimes they kind of just forget that. And then we kind of go down and just read everything. And then we talk about CG, the GMI. This is kind of the new thing, and us being able to take all of our continuous glucose data. And y'all, I'm gonna tell you, Tidepool giving me a GMI has given me a little bit of flexibility in requiring an A1C, having to send a patient to a lab right now in the middle of all of this. If I have a CGM data and I have a GMI, I'm going to wait 3 to 6 months before I get a A1C. Right now, that's the choice that we've made in our office. We have this data. We know that research has shown us that this is an accurate number. And the cool thing is our view is no different than the patient. So patients can see this at their house as well. So we like to do that. And then I go over to trends. And if I'm going to make a decision based on what Chris has done and the information on our screen, I'm not going to look at individual before I look at the trend. So I kind of look and see, okay, obviously from here to here, we're having elevated blood glucoses. And then I'll kind of talk to the patient about it and they're going to start giving me feedback. I encourage patients who can to pull up their Tide Pool and I don't even have to share my screen and they can kind of scroll through. But sometimes they'll be like, well, Miss Jessica, can you go and look at, you know, Sunday and said, well, that was Sunday. So they said, can you just go and look at Friday? And they want to tell me something. So this patient was working in the yard and they were like, this is what happened. Well, they didn't give me a note. So we can put a note right here. And so I can literally say working in the yard and I can show, well, if I could spell, that would help. And I can show them to use this if they haven't already. And we can go through a couple of pieces. And Chris does this too. So sometimes I'll come in and Chris has left notes already. But we use this to make decisions. And what it does is it allows me to look at the trend graph. I can look at a trend graph. I can look at daily data. And I can make an adjustment without patient input. And we do that in between visits. But then if we're going to get really deep into it, I'm going to need to have a conversation with the patient, being able to understand what they see. And the reason also that we use Tide Pool is second graders learn how to read graphs, and colors and graphing is something any child can understand, which means we know that we're going to have the patients and the child being able to, the parents and the child being able to do interactively understanding instead of it being just so complex of information and then we can't get anywhere. So this is what I do in our visit. And then I kind of shut that down and I stop. And then I just kind of go back to communicating. But that's exactly what happens in our office too. I actually found one of my biggest mistakes in the office, which was easy to fix here doing telehealth, is sometimes I wouldn't shut the Tide Pool off. And then I'd want to kind of have conversations about changing insulin dosages or talking about labs or putting in prescriptions. And they wouldn't stop staring at Tide Pool. And I would lose them, or the parent would keep getting madder and madder and madder at what was in front of them. And so I've learned to kind of, I have to shift back. When you are on telehealth, it's very difficult to remember that. So I've been very intentional to see on Zoom, it has this bar that says, it's like green and red, and it says stop and share. And so I've kind of had to visually remember that. And so I actually practiced that. I actually made a note and said, okay, make sure you shift your screen back. That's one of the biggest things that I have struggled with, because then they're not paying attention to the last part of our visit. And so once I make all of the adjustments, I put in the prescriptions through our EMR, and that's on my left screen. I then make the adjustments, document it, but if it is not a pump, I put the insulin dose recommendations in chat and tell them to copy that. It's in their chart and I can make them an insulin dose sheet, but right now while they're at home, the parents are doing it and they can copy it and then they can paste it wherever they want or they can write it down. All of my pump patients, I have them change their settings while they are on the phone with me and they just verify it. And that works out well. And then because our office staff are working from home, because all we see is diabetes here, so there's no reason why we can't do 100% of our patients this way, I actually look at the schedule and I schedule my patients. I ask them the date and time if that works out. And then I send my front office staff the date and time and let them put it in the schedule, because providers should never touch their own schedules. We mess it up all the time. And so I can get a date and time right, but if I try to put it on the schedule, I mess it up every single time. So that's kind of how I finish the visit. And it just depends however long Chris has spent versus how long I've spent. The process goes pretty smoothly for the most part, until we have like the glitches where somebody's audio doesn't work and I can see them or they can see me, but we can't hear them. And so we'll pick up the phone and we'll call the patient and we'll do a video, but their audio is on their phone. And that's worked pretty well too. So that is my end of the medical management side of us working through the telehealth.
So all told, for a given patient, I guess, given their needs and how new they are to diabetes, it sort of vary, but all told, for a patient that is experienced with their diabetes management and it's just like a routine visit, going through or having their appointment with Chris and then being handed off to you, Jessica, how long would you say that they're spending in Zoom with the two of you over the course of a given
appointment? Well, with Chris, it can be anywhere between 30 minutes to an hour, because they can be really experienced and really good with technology. But if they are having a really big diabetes off day, that's a lot that they're going to have to do. And then a lot of times, the more time they spend with him, the less time they'll spend with me, because if they're having a really bad diabetes off day and emotionally they're just spent, they're probably making emotional decisions in their management, which means we probably need to step back and punt and do a follow-up and just kind of reset. So it's usually no more than about an hour and a half. Every once in a while we can get like an hour and 15 minutes, but honestly, y'all, that's how it is in our office too. Our patients, we're not in and out. We work together to kind of give them the time they need. And we flip-flop patients a lot to make, if we're having a really complicated patient, we'll flip-flop patients. Because the two of us kind of work seamlessly that way.
Yeah. Do have a couple of quick questions in from the attendees. Thank you everybody for using that Q&A button at the bottom. I guess we're going to go for maybe another 10 minutes tops. Question from Ariel, do you take insurance? And I guess the broader question there is sort of, how do you navigate all the billing and payment and provider or payer stuff now that you are exclusively, telehealth, telemedicine?
Right now, because of the wonderful laws that were put in place, thanks to the COVID lessening of restrictions, we accept all insurances except Medicare. And that was before we went to all telehealth anyway. So we have been doing this since right around St. Patrick's Day, I guess, is when we, because they canceled Savannah St. Patrick's Day parade. And within 2 days, we just kind of flipped the switch and said, okay, we know it's coming. We were doing this before shelter in place was put in place for Georgia. And so we've gotten payments back and we haven't had any denials yet. And everything seems to be going well. And that includes Medicaid patients.
Okay, cool. So a question from Kathleen, I think this was sort of covered a little bit by you, Chris, but just more explicitly, do you have people that your patients here uploading meters, CGM in pen, like are they uploading the full gamut of stuff, or is there anything that, and I guess more directly, are there patients that you are prescribing specific devices because they are type 1 compatible if they're newly diagnosed or anything like that? Like how do you sort of navigate the device compatibility where type 1 is today with what your patients are able to access and what do you think that they need?
That's a good question. We made a choice. Let me preface it by saying this. So Jessica and I we're business owners and we are providers for these patients, but we are also both parents of a type 1. So she and her husband have a type 1, my wife and I have a type 1. When we make decisions in this practice, it's through the lens of being parents of a type 1. It's not just what makes sense for business, what makes sense for insurance. We do some things that people told us in the very beginning, you're crazy, you'll never make money doing that. You spend how long with a patient? And I say, listen, when my son was first diagnosed, I prayed that people would spend that much time with me. So we never compromise on our systems that we have in place here. We will spend more money on things that make people feel like they are a part of this EDC family. In regards to in regards to equipment, we kind of have self-labeled ourselves as a patient choice center. People ask us all the time, so what pump does your son wear? And I go, not telling you. And they go, well, why won't you just tell me? I say, because I need for you to hear kind of an unbiased opinion or some unbiased conversation about these different pumps. And you need to make the decision for what you think fits best for your life, because what my son's involved in and what your son is involved in, two completely different situations. What he uses may not work for you. Just because he's my son and I'm one of the owners here, don't put too much stock in what I'm doing, because it may not fit what you're doing. So we don't generally talk about our, we talk about our kids all the time, but we don't talk about what equipment they use for the sole purpose that we want patients to, for instance, attend our, we have a class called Stay Pumped, and they go to the Stay Pump class, and we invite all of the local pump reps to come and present their products. And before that, patients don't know what our kids are on. They get to come to the class, decide what product they want. It just so happens that the pumps are compatible with Tidepool, but we don't suggest products just because they are compatible with Tidepool. We love Tidepool. We are huge supporters of Tidepool, but Tidepool is not the end all when we're making decisions. It's really the patient. What is going to be best for the patient?
Well,
you know, everybody has opinions on CGMs, but if this CGM, even though it's super popular, is not going to be best for this patient for maybe money reasons or insurance reasons, then let's go to this CGM, right? So that's kind of the patient is always at the center.
I will say, though, that if you're looking at, say, let's use a newly diagnosed patient. I think that was part of the question. A newly diagnosed patient who, like in our world, in Georgia, WellCare. So we know that a newly diagnosed patient is coming into our center. Actually, the one we just had coming into our center, WellCare. They're using the required meter is a one touch. Well, so we can use our forethought to go, okay, we don't even know what phone, whatever they have, but we know we're going to want to them to eventually get to Tidepool at some point somehow, or we want to get a report. So that means the easiest thing to do is to put them on a one touch meter that has Bluetooth capability, because if nothing else, that meter and the phone can talk to one another. If that is an Android phone, they can still send us a one drop report. So that means we're going to put them on a one touch Vireo Flex. If they are on Amerigroup in Georgia, that is a True Metrics. And people are like, oh, but you can't do anything with that. You can't upload it. Well, in our office, we can upload any True Metrics, but from home, they need a True Metrics Air. Insurance doesn't care if it's Bluetooth. They will pay for it. The only one that we cannot upload from home is a Freestyle. And we have tons of track hair, so we have to get creative with that right now. So we do try to use, like, knowing that they should use Bluetooth. We'll say, this is the particular meter. It doesn't matter what strips, as long as it's of the One Touch class or of the True Metrics class. That's all the insurances actually care about.
Right on. I think if you haven't already, please send me an email about the meters that your patients, the One Touch ones that are not compatible with Tidepool, just so I can log that request with our support team. As a quick reminder to everybody, if you have any questions or comments about anything that you've seen, you can always go to tidepool.org/telemedicine to engage with all the telemedicine resources that we've created for you and your patients. As a reminder, next week we have a webinar with Dr. Bill Polonsky talking about mental health tips. You can register for that webinar at tidepool.org/webinars. And when in doubt, support@tidepool.org is the email address for any questions or any concerns or any feedback, anything you want to share. support@tidepool.org is the place for all of that. Again, that has been it from me, Christopher Snyder, Community Manager at Tidepool, on behalf of Chris Britt and Jessica Adkins at Everyday Diabetes Center. Thank you for attending this Tidepool for Telemedicine webinar, and we'll see you on the next one. Take care, everybody.